Come, Holy Spirit, come now, come as you wish. Come, Holy Spirit, come now, come as you wish. Come, Holy Spirit, come now, come as you wish. One of the new things which was somehow partially known in the Old Testament was brought, confirmed, and raised to the absolutely impossible thing is the definition of God. There's only one definition of God in the first letter of St. John, that God is love. He's not made of love, he's not full of love, he is love. Some people are asking, will God be not short on love? This is like asking the sun, S-U-N, if it will be short on the shining and heat, or like asking water, when water will be short of wetness. That's how gracious God is, and the new things also which Jesus brought is not only to love one another, but to love as He loved us, the sacrificial love, the love which doesn't count, which doesn't calculate, but is wishing well, even up to the point of death. But today I want to show you something else. Sometimes people will present a distortion of the gentle mission in the early church. They will even pit Paul against Peter. Some of them, they will say that Peter did not believe that the gospel should go to the Gentiles. They were very hesitate with this. And even they will put a scripture that Paul had to convince Peter, because Paul calls himself the apostles to the Gentiles, as the rest of the apostles should be for the Jews. It's not true, because almost all of them, they were killed outside of Israel for preaching the gospel, but it's very important to know and understand it. It's crucial to note that the first conversion of the Gentiles took place with Peter, not with Paul. The conversion of Cornelius, which we have in today's first reading. Peter was very hesitant to make this step. He knew that he's somehow crossing this red line, and after he crosses it, there's no way back. When you open the gate to the Gentiles in the church, they'll be just following the whole mission to the rest of the world. That's why they were somehow pushed out of Israel by the persecution, but Peter made this first step. So it took this miracle of the falling of the Holy Spirit on Cornelius and his household to really kickstart the Gentile mission properly. They were waiting for the sign from heaven. That is not my idea, it's not Jewish kingdom only, but God is spreading His kingdom all over the world. And Peter's statement that anyone who does right in any nation is acceptable to God can be taken out of context. You have to know how it was understood from the beginning and how it was always taught in the church. It can be taken in a direction of relativism or universalism, which says that all religions are created equal. If you just sometimes compare them, you will see they are not equal, and it was never taught like this by church. So the church has never taken Peter's words to mean that all religions are created equal, or that it doesn't really matter what religion you belong to. As long as you are a good person, you can be saved. That's not what Jesus said. You can't find this sentence in the gospel. Jesus said, if you don't eat my bread, if you don't drink my blood, you have no life in you. He didn't say you have to be the good person. That's a totally different criteria. And that's not what Peter says here in this text. So just pay attention what is important. Cornelius was a righteous pagan who feared God, gave alms, he was praying, but who had not yet heard the good news of Jesus' passion, death, and resurrection, who did not accept the plan of salvation, who was not even properly informed about the plan of salvation. He had some idea coming from the prayer. That's not all what he has, that he needs something more. When he prayed to God, his prayers and alms ascended before God. So God could hear his prayer. God was not bound to bring grace and salvation to this man. I hope you know you can and you should pray even in your sin. That's the teaching of many saints. God hears your prayer and He wants to bring you to repentance. He wants to bring you to the unity of Him. So there is no any any obstacle on the side of God. You have to remember that in some way God is much more interested in our salvation than me, than ourselves. It's his investment, and he wants to protect it, and he wants to bring it to fulfillment. So Cornelius, moved by grace, tries to do God's will as he knows, as he understands it, through the dictates of his conscience, which was limited at this time, at this point, and mixed good things with absolutely errors. There is a very vivid example. He tries to worship Peter because he doesn't quite understand the fullness of the truth. You have to turn to God, you have to worship Jesus and honoring the others, but worshiping God. So he had quite complicated view of religion, and he was purified. Yet the church is saying that in those cases, when people have even this confusion, there is a real possibility for those people to be saved. It out of not of their fault, they didn't hear. They didn't have chance to learn about salvation in Jesus. The Catechism of the Catholic Church says, in ways known to God himself, those who sincerely follow their conscience, those who are moved by grace, those who seek God with a sincere heart, they can be saved. I mean, we have to follow the truth. We have to find the answers. You can always answer to yourself and to someone who is challenging your faith, are you searching for the answer? Is somehow dishonest if you question your faith, or if you allow to be questioned and you do not search for the answer? It's not honest approach. So we don't know how this salvation happens. It's known to God, between God and the person, between God and the conscience of the person. But the church makes it very clear that all salvation comes through Christ and through Christ alone. This is what Jesus said. I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. If you don't have him, you have nothing. So even all worldly religion or people without religion, at the point of dying, they will have to say yes or no to Christ. Say quicker, it will be easier on the other side. Therefore, the sacred obligation to evangelize, to share the gospel, to bring the sacraments to the nations, still remains the church's primary mission. Our faith formation teaching is above donuts and coffee, above any other things, because that's the primary mission of the church, to teach. And that's why it's an important thing. I will give you some comparison to give you just only one, because it will be too long in many things. The Eastern religions have a very different concept of God than Christians. And you have to start somehow from this point. Some people would say it's not really honest to compare the divine person of Jesus with Buddha, because you compare God with the creature, God with man. But people who do not accept Jesus, they see him as the founder of the religion. So even in this comparison, you will see that it's something more than human. For them, for the Eastern religion, God is an impersonal cosmic energy, and humans can merge with the Godhead through the technique of meditation. Through the meditation, you try to reach a state of unity, consciousness with the Absolute. Now, this was very much pointed by John Paul II. He was attacked for this statement that these Eastern religions are godless religions. All the people were very much offended by this. But it truly is. It's my technique. It's my meditation. It's my doing. So who is saving me? I'm saving myself. And just see how they explain it. Christians understand that we are individual persons. We do not melt into God. We still stay as a people. For Eastern religions, religion is an illusion. They say, if I say me, it's an illusion. Me doesn't exist. And they have very good explanation for it. At the ocean, we see waves caused by the wind, and every one of these waves could say, see how beautiful I am. But they are only a part of the ocean. And they explain, if a drop of water splashes into the air, it has an illusion of an independent existence. Eventually, it falls back into the ocean to become one with it again. That's not Christian teaching. even after the people die, after they are canonized, we call them Saint Teresa of Lisieux, Saint Teresa of Calcutta, Saint Teresa of Avila, and so on. They don't disappear. The goal of the natural mystics is to unify yourself with everything. When you return into the ocean, you will lose this illusion of personal me. With whom are you identifying? To whom are you surrounding? And we know from the creation is good and evil. If you are not sure that evil exists in the world, just look this daily news after 10 o'clock in the evening. So to whom are you surrounding if you are not surrounding to God? And how is it even possible to lose this personal me? They are giving this physical example. The physics, there is a distinction between positive and negative electric charges, the battery like in the car. Don't do it to your battery because you will kill your battery. Joined or fastened together, they are discharged. They are completely neutralized. They are good for nothing. So putting on the spiritual level, we as people are in contact with the energy of the earth, walking on the earth. So with our heads, we are touching the energy of heaven. Through the yoga meditation, the earthly energy has to be lifted up through the body to the top of the head to be neutralized. Then by being connected, an illusion of an individual person disappears. But who is doing this if me disappears? Everything is directed towards the chakra to activate it, to achieve the physical exercises, breathing techniques, focusing on your vision or hearing. All this is to reach a state of unity consciousness with everything which is called in different tradition samadhi, nirvana or moksha. Heard this, they are more or less the same direction. So why would one enter such an activity? What does it achieve? Why it is attractive to the people? The aim is to remove the essence of individual being which can suffer. The pharmaceutical industry never suffered, even in the Great Recession. So in suffering, we say very simply, I am suffering, I am tired, I have a problem, I am afraid, I am depressed, I have had enough. So what is the problem? I is the problem. So Buddha says life is suffering. And he was right. There's plenty of suffering in our lives. But how do we avoid suffering? How do you deal with your suffering? So Buddha said suffering comes from desires. So we suffer because we desire and our desires are not fulfilled and the suffering increases. Again, Buddha was right. So what can we do? And he's giving quite a prescription for it. Stop desiring. As long as you remain an individual person, you will desire and you will suffer. So you have to renounce your personal I to stop suffering. But who is renouncing this personal I? Or who is keeping this decision alive? It's not very much logical. It's appealing to the people, but it doesn't hold the water. So Buddha is proposing to go out of this life, running away from suffering, and to withdraw into the womb of matter of nature to completely lose your personal identity, to be melted with the ocean, to be melted with God. According to experts, it is really a state of happiness. Now people are inventing the state of happiness. Some invent it by abusing alcohol, other drugs, other natural religions. There is less side effect. You don't have hangover after praying natural religion. So despite this assurance, there is something missing. It is true, there is no more suffering which can suffer if you remove your I, but there is also no being which could love. So these natural, nature-directed ways, with all their efficient techniques, truly lead to a state where we will suffer no more. But the price for this is to renounce love. Maybe it's not by chance that it's on the Mother's Day when this topic comes. Another option is given by Jesus, the one who is divine. we should try to go through life with courage, carrying our cross. Jesus will always help us, not running away from life, by embracing it. Remember, the last word belongs to the incarnated love, to Jesus who came to save us. So love is not an illusion in Christian world, but the goal of our lives, both here on earth and in our transition to eternity. There's a great need to expose this difference, which is impossible, completely impossible to compromise. I'll give you some examples that you can understand. The way of Buddha contains 12 steps. On step 5, you should renounce an illusion of love. And why they insist on this? Buddha teaches that hate and love support that illusion of I. So that's why you should renounce it. I hate, I love. So you are supporting this so-called illusion. And Buddha teaches that love is an illusion you have to move past. But if you and I do not exist, then love does not exist either. It's the consequence of it. In the entire Bible, there is only one definition of God, written for Christians by St. John in his first letter. God is love. And that's what is all around this not created love. St. John says very clearly, love is of God. Everyone who loves is begotten by God and knows God. What are you comparing? There is nothing really to compare. Buddha teaches that love is an illusion. And the Bible teaches, St. John says, whoever is without love does not know God. Straight from the scripture. And Buddha teaches again, he who loves is living in an illusion. It's impossible to believe both. You must choose if we have to declare to believe one or the other. That cannot be in the water and in the fire. One should win. It's very insightful to compare the differences between the death of Buddha and Jesus, which obviously points to the divinity of Jesus. Buddha is sick, Buddha is dying. He calls his disciples, he gives them the last instructions. But he doesn't say, I will give you life, I will protect you. They never even claim it. Then Buddha closes himself in the heart of the cosmos, which is represented by one of the chakras, and Buddha gathers all his energy in one of the chakras, which reminds us of a child in the womb of its mother, and then he dies. In some way, he disappears in himself, focused on himself. And how does Jesus die? He does not turn inward on himself. And even on physical images, obvious, he remains completely open because he is crucified. You cannot be more open than that. So not focusing on himself at all. When I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw everyone to myself. There was no payment, there was no reward to Jesus for the passion on the cross. He did it out of love to bring us back to the heavenly kingdom. And that's why he said, I am the way and the truth and the life. And only through him is the access to the eternal kingdom. So Jesus was opened up to the breaking point being crucified. And from his pierced heart, there will always flow a stream of love, the spirit of love. Every time you receive the Holy Communion, you receive this uncreated love just for you. Jesus was challenging Julian of Norwich, one of the English mystics from 14th century, pointing to his passion. He was saying, you will find nothing else than love as the motivation for all of this, what he had done for our salvation. Be open to it. Take it. Let it be part of your life. Buddha closed into himself, afraid of suffering, refusing to go forward, not giving any solution, any real answer for the people. Jesus opened up willingly, accepting his suffering for the salvation of the world. That was the purpose of his coming. On the very first Sunday of Easter morning, Jesus overcomes death, sin, and Satan, the prince of darkness, the chief rebellion against God. It is completely impossible for Christians to believe and accept that love is just an illusion. Because of love of God, we have received our eternity. Love brought us salvation. And on the very human, earthly level, love brings happiness and fulfillment to life. So that's a choice everyone has to make, God or man, revealed religion or invented religion. And to encourage you, Saint Augustine, one of the church fathers, said, "He who created us without our help will not save us without our consent." Now, nobody asked me if I want to be born, and I was born. But God wants my yes, take his hand to be saved. And no one really can do this decision for you. We can pray for each other, we can support each other, but the decision is yours. St. Augustine said also, "My love is what gives me true value." So don't be afraid of love. Engage it. Sit in the church out of love to God, trying to glorify him. Any activity, offer it to the glory of God. And you will experience this amazing gift which God is giving us through Christ to bring us closer to his kingdom and eventually enjoying the fullness of his glory.